Okay.
All right, welcome and good afternoon. Thank you for joining us. This is the fifth installment of the Texas Wildlife Association's Stewardship Seminar Series, Wild at Work. We are joined by a fantastic partner and collaborator today, the Tarrant Regional Water District. Katie Myers serves as TRWD's Rural Programs Coordinator with the Watershed Protection Team. Katie is a native Texan, a Baylor Bear with a grad degree from Duke University in environmental management. She's going to be speaking to us this afternoon on how wildlife habitat restoration benefits water supply and watershed health. So Katie, I will turn it over to you. And if you wouldn't mind just explaining a little bit about TRWD and the role that you have there, and then we'll launch into things.
All right. I actually have what TRWD is, elevator speech, built into this presentation. So I am just going to start rolling. I also want to mention that my colleague Michelle is on the call. Like Andrew said, I'm the rural programs coordinator. Michelle is the urban programs coordinator for our watershed protection team. She is going to be in the chat, so you can throw out questions at any time. If it's something that she can answer quickly, she'll just answer it in the chat. Otherwise, we'll kind of add it to the deck of questions to answer at the end. So ask away throughout the whole presentation and we'll do what we can as we move. So really quick overview of what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to talk a little bit about what watershed protection is and in that what TRWD is. Then we're going to make the connection between watershed protection and wildlife. And then hopefully I'll have time to run through a few TRWD programs that benefit wildlife. So first, what is TRWD? We are a Tarrant Regional Water District. We are a regional raw water supplier. We own and operate 4 source water reservoirs that you can see in this picture over here. Can we see my mouse if I mouse around over this? Cool, okay. So we built and operate these 4 reservoirs, Bridgeport, Eagle Mountain, Cedar Creek, and Richland Chambers. There are another couple of terminal storage reservoirs that are located up here in the Metroplex. But as far as where we are actually sourcing the water that we are selling to cities, it is from these 4 big reservoirs. Raw water means that we are not in the water treatment business. We are just in the water collection and storage and transport business. So, oh my God, I just scrolled my mouse. Okay. So my team works throughout the drainage areas or the watersheds of these 4 reservoirs, just trying to make sure that the water flowing into them is as clean as possible. This water is really critically important. We have over 70 customer cities and municipalities, and that goes on to almost 2.5 million end users in an 11 county area. And so this is obviously massively important. The DFW Metro is growing at a very fast rate. So this is absolutely critical water supply. We also operate the Fort Worth floodway within the city of Fort Worth. That's kind of the grayish blob that you see in the middle is where the Fort Worth floodway protects. So that's the levee system through Fort Worth, if any of y'all are DFW local. And then we also operate recreation facilities at a number of these reservoirs. So I just threw out a lot of words like watershed. So let's rewind and go back to watershed basics. So a watershed is basically just our little diagram here, these would kind of be our ridge lines up around the edge of the watershed. And so any rainfall that falls within those ridge lines is going to flow down to a specific body of water. In this case, the river that's flowing through the middle. A watershed has 3 main components to it. We have an upland, so that's the land surface area. We have a riparian area or a floodplain, and then we have the body of water itself. All 3 of these things have to work together for the system to be in balance. So if we're changing any one thing about that system, we're changing any one component, we can kind of change the function of the other components. So if I'm in a forested watershed and I go and I clear cut the upland, that is going to affect how the river is functioning. If I decide to take out my entire floodplain or riparian buffer or put the whole river in levees, that is going to change how the body of water functions. So again, everything is kind of connected in this landscape. So now what is watershed protection? What water quality issues are we looking at? A lot of times when we think about pollution, we automatically think of something called point source pollution. And point source is kind of exactly what it sounds like. It is pollution that you can tie to a specific point. So think about, you know, a factory and a big pipe dumping sludge into the water, or a water treatment facility dumping its effluent into the water that might still have certain chemicals or nutrients in it. Those are coming from a very specific point. We can say this pollutant came from pollution. So these are sources that are coming from the broader landscape. It's coming from things that are happening across large land areas. And this can be, you know, both rural and urban. So in a city landscape, you might be thinking about there's a lot of roads, there's a lot of parking lot, those kinds of surface areas. And there's grime and dirt and oils and chemicals dripping off of cars. There might be chemicals that people are using in landscaping. And so when it rains, all of that stuff is going to wash off into a storm drain or into a creek. Our watersheds for TRWD are really outside of the metro area. So we are looking at primarily rural agricultural landscapes, and that kind of has its own set of water quality issues. A big one is gonna be sediment coming off of the landscape. We're gonna have agricultural chemicals. So that's fertilizers, herbicides, pesticides, and also nutrients, again, from the fertilizers, but also coming from like cattle, livestock, and bacteria coming from those animals as well. Okay, I have a few like quiz or poll questions that I've built into this PowerPoint. So we're gonna try it and see if it works. I'm gonna flip to the slide with the question, and I want y'all, nobody freak out about this. You're not being graded. And I haven't necessarily told you the answers yet. This is just kind of a check-in to see where people are at. And I might have thrown a few tricksy things in there. So just don't stress about it. Okay, so the first one, and just popped up. What is the most common water quality impairment in the state of Texas? I just threw out a whole bunch of different water quality things. So which one do you think is our most common issue in this state?
We will give folks just a few minutes to, or pardon me, a few seconds to get that their answers logged in. And then we will close out that poll, and it should pop up on the results should pop up on the screen for you. Looks like sediment and bacteria are the two leading answers here. So I will close out the poll and then turn it back to you, Katie.
Okay, great. So it looks like those are sharing. I don't know where y'all are seeing this on your screen or if it's blocking my slide. Let me click to the next slide and see what happens. Is that still showing on the screen?
Yes. And okay. Can you see the poll results?
Yes, I sure can. So it looks like we had about half of people saying sediment. We had another quarter of people saying bacteria. Those are the two that I was aiming for. So great job. This is where it gets a little tricksy. So I used a word in that question, impairment. And impairment is a regulatory word. And this is something that comes out of the Clean Water Act. And there are a number of different pollutants that have certain thresholds, right? And we do regular water quality testing for those pollutants. Sediment is not one of those pollutants. Sediment is a big pollutant, and it is primarily what we manage for as watershed coordinators, watershed protection. But in terms of what our regulatory thresholds are, bacteria is going to be the most common impairment that we see flagged from the state. So it's kind of an interesting wrinkle because we have a responsibility as, you know, a water district, as a water authority to address water bodies that have been flagged through this regulatory framework. And again, you can see all these little red lines. Bacteria is the one that we get flagged for the most. So we have to address that, but we actually kind of tend to address it more through sediment. And I will explain why we focus on sediment here. So sediment is the thing that I am targeting in my watershed protection efforts most often, even though this is not one of our listed pollutants. So number one is we're kind of hitting a number of different things if we try to control for sediment. This is both a water quality and a water quantity issue. So I'm going to start with quantity because the mission of my organization is to provide water to 2.5 million and counting people. So I need to make sure that sediment is not flowing into the reservoirs because that sediment is going to fill the reservoirs up over time. Sediment is flowing through these creeks and rivers. And then when it gets to a reservoir, that water slows down. It no longer has the energy to keep that sediment suspended. So it's going to settle down to the bottom of the reservoir. And over time, that layer of sediment is going to get deeper and deeper and deeper, which means that the water holding capacity of the reservoir is decreasing. Obviously, with us trying to feed a growing metro area, the absolute last thing that we want as a water supplier is to be losing capacity in our reservoirs. So that's reason number one to target sediment. Reason number two is that if I target sediment, I can actually hit a lot of my water quality goals at the same time. The same management practices that are going to reduce sediment are going to reduce a lot of those other water quality issues like the nutrients and the bacteria. And there are a few ways that it does that. So another concern with sediment is that it's going to increase the turbidity or the murkiness of the water. This is an issue for wildlife because some fish like a real turbid, murky environment and some really, really don't. In general, what we want to do is preserve whatever the natural state of that stream would have been. So we don't want to take, you know, a previously pretty clear creek and dump a bunch of sediment into it because that means that the aquatic life that was there before is now going to be, you know, unable to live there. We might be pushing them out of their thresholds of, you know, turbidity in which they can survive. So we really just want to preserve whatever was there before. Number two is that streams that are carrying a really high sediment load have more erosive power, which then accelerates in-stream erosion. So it's kind of this positive feedback spiral. One way to think about it is if you've ever been to the beach and you like stand in the surf and it's kind of a choppy day and the water comes up and it hits your legs, it feels like your legs get sandblasted because there's so much sand suspended in the water. That's kind of what's happening in a really turbid stream is you have all of this, all these sediment particles that are suspended in the water. And so as that water is flowing down the stream, those particles are actually helping to scour out the bed and the banks of the stream. So we are accelerating the erosion within the stream itself. And then the other really important thing is that sediment can hold on to other pollutants. So it can hold on to pollutants that are happening from current land management practices, but some sediments can also hold on to legacy pollutants. So sometimes, right, there are some pollutants that don't break down over time. So we can get things, you know, entering into our water bodies, maybe is a legacy from a land use or a land management practice that was happening decades ago. But then that sediment washes into the water and those pollutants that are bound up in it become dissolved into the water. And now it's a water quality issue. One of the really interesting things is that our biggest watershed, Richland Chambers, is located primarily within the Blackland Prairie. And there's, you know, I don't know how many of y'all are from that area, but there's a very specific soil type, right? And it's a really fine, highly mobile soil. And one of the really interesting things about clay soils, this is going to get a little
Katie, I think you might be having some connection issues. You seem to have frozen. We'll give it just a minute and see if we can get you unfrozen. I'm not sure if that's just my computer or if others are having that issue as well.
Yeah, I'm seeing the same thing.
Okay. Thank you. I think she dropped off and will join us again here in just a minute.
Sorry about that. She is popping back on and I'm currently answering some really great questions in the Q&A. So I'm going to keep typing there. Like, there she is. You're still on mute, Katie. You're still on mute. So sorry.
Okay. I'm trying to connect to a different yes, the joys of technology. I questioned doing this from home, but if I did it in the office, people would have just been walking into my office in the background because they do that all day. And I would have been shooing them out of the background, but maybe that would have been better. Okay. Michelle said I was cutting in and out a little bit during that in the first place. So let's join a different Wi-Fi. I'm so sorry, everyone. Bear with me for like 3 seconds.
You're all good. Yeah, I think you were lagging there just a couple times. And then the last one, I cut out for a little bit and fell off. But we'll hop right back in just a minute. A brief intermission, everyone.
Oh, well, I don't know if it wants to let me join my hotspot. It does not want to let me join my work hotspot. So we might have to roll with what I've got. And worst case scenario, you'll get a really fun ad lib from Michelle. And I'm sure she's thrilled about that possibility.
Katie, sometimes something that can help is if you turn your video off, just because it's one less data stream. So.
Okay, well, I'm sorry you'll all be denied this, but I will try that. Okay, I'm gonna try that and we're just gonna jump back into it. Okay, let's see if I can share again. Andrew, you might have to make me a host again. Oh, never mind. I still have the button. I still have the magic button. Okay, we're back and I'm hidden and now I'm going to keep talking. Okay, I think I dropped out somewhere where I was geeking out about clay soils. Long story short, they can hold on to pollutants. Pollutants get into the water body, and then those pollutants can become, you know, redissolved into the water, even if it's, you know, a chemical that hasn't been used on the landscape for a long time. So all in all, we control for sediment above all other pollutants, because basically if we can keep sediment out of the water body, we're keeping pretty much everything else out of the water body too. If we can arrest that before it reaches the water, then we're in good shape. I'm still gesturing as if I'm on camera. Just so y'all know, I'm over here pantomiming in the background. Okay, so in short, everything that happens across the landscape within a watershed is going to affect the quality and quantity of the water in the lakes and streams. So we have a couple of different options to address these issues. One is that we can take extra water treatment steps. We can just say, oh, well, that's not our problem. But that infrastructure is really, really costly. And of course, it doesn't make the water bodies themselves safe to use directly for people or for wildlife. So the other option is that we can target the sources of the pollutants with appropriate best management practices, where we prevent those pollutants in the first place, or we trap them before they reach the body of water. Now, the great thing about this option is that these often have benefits for native ecosystems, and are usually more cost-effective in the long run than, you know, using gray infrastructure or treatment infrastructure as a solution. In the long run is kind of the key point there. A lot of times doing these more, you know, natural prevention techniques, there can be an upfront cost. A lot of times we don't like to do them because of that upfront cost, but common adage, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. That's kind of the crux of how we operate. And so the second option, targeting the sources of the pollution, of the pollutants, that's basically what watershed protection is. So going back to water quality issues, again, our landscapes are largely rural. And the crux of mitigating sediment pollution from large rural landscapes is the land cover. So really good ground cover benefits us in a number of ways. First, if you're thinking about the rain falling from the sky, if I have really good ground cover, the leaves and stems of those plants are going to intercept the rainfall and prevent it from directly impacting the soil surface. If you've ever seen a raindrop fall and hit a really dusty, dry surface, you see that there's a little plume of dust that comes up around it. So on a dry, exposed surface, the raindrops themselves are dislodging soil, but good ground cover prevents that from happening. And then as the water reaches the surface and it begins to flow across the surface, all those little stems sticking up from the ground are helping to slow the overland flow. So think of it kind of like a Plinko board, right? This water is having to bounce off of all the stems sticking up out of the ground. And then lastly, having a really good living root going into the soil is providing infiltration pathways for the water. So we're allowing the water to soak into the soil. So on the flip side, if we have really poor ground cover, we are going to have the opposite of all of those effects. So poor ground cover, right? I don't have leaves and stems protecting the surface from the impact of the rainfall. The water, so we have, right, immediately upon impact, dislodging of soil particles. As the water flows across the surface, there's nothing to slow it down. So that is going to have even more erosive power. We're going to be cutting away more soil as it flows. And then I don't have really good and abundant roots going into the soil, so I'm not getting a lot of infiltration. So how does this all connect to wildlife? The answer is pretty simple. Healthy habitats equal healthy water. So if you were thinking of yourself as a critter, and you had to choose to live on the left or on the right. So the left is a Bermuda grass monoculture. This would be for forage or for haying. The right is a thriving native prairie. Where would you rather be? And the answer in almost all cases is going to be on the right, right? You want a thriving habitat. And the great thing about ecosystems is that they are a functional whole. So if we're looking to optimize the function of an ecosystem, we can really focus on whatever function we want. And if we boost that function, we're gonna boost a bunch of other functions. So for example, right, my job is to protect the water quality in the reservoirs. So if I want to have really good ground cover, I'm gonna say, hey, look, this native prairie has amazing ground cover. It has really deep roots going into the soil. I want to do that to protect water quality. this is also going to benefit native wildlife. It's also going to benefit, you know, carbon sequestration and storage. So we have a climate benefit there. It's also going to benefit the soil health. It's going to benefit, you know, the soil sediment retention. So just by focusing on water, I've managed to benefit a whole bunch of other things in the process. Again, a functional whole. So we feed any one of those benefits, we're going to feed the other benefits of a healthy ecosystem as well. Okay, this is another slightly mean question where I have not given you the answer yet, but there's a method to the madness, and hopefully we will see it in a minute. So if Andrew can throw the next poll up there, we're gonna see where my DFW natives are. What are the two predominant ecoregions in the DFW area? I have a number of options up there. I did already talk about one of these, so you should be able to eliminate one. I did this same webinar with the Texas Waters Specialist Group. And so that's a lot of people who have been through Master Naturalist training, and they absolutely aced this. So either they were all from DFW or they've all studied that ecoregions map and just know it like the back of their hand. So we'll see how this group does. All right, I'm gonna give about 5 more seconds on that.
Perfect. There is definitely a clear winner. I will close out this poll here in just a second and turn the results back to you, Katie.
Okay. And the clear winner is correct. Y'all know what you are talking about. So the two major ecoregions that we are dealing with in our watersheds are the cross timbers and the blackland prairie. I'm going to move this out of the way. Okay. So y'all didn't get to see the outlines of the watersheds before yet, I think, but these kind of gray blobs are the outlines of the watersheds. There's Bridgeport, Eagle Mountain, Richland Chambers, and Cedar Creek. And you can see that most of our area is falling within this green, which is Blackland Prairie, and this kind of reddish color, which is cross timbers. Cedar Creek does dip over into what this particular ecoregion map is calling East Central Texas Plains. We would more colloquially call this the post-oak savanna. So we do have a good amount of post-oak savanna. And then here in the most northern reaches of these watersheds, we are, you know, kind of pushing up into the central Great Plains. Now, the reason that this is important is because when we're thinking about what best management practices we want to put on the landscape, we have to have regional considerations, right? There's not a big, you know, nationwide or even Texas-wide handbook on what the best
Katie, I think we might have lost your audio there again. Are you still with us? All right, Katie, I think we might need you to pop off and pop back on once more. I think that's what she's doing right now. Sorry, everyone. Meantime, if folks would like to explore the chat, I know Michelle has been in there answering lots of questions from everyone, as well as in the Q&A tab. So feel free to read up on some of the FAQs that have been rolling in so far.
Yes, I'm currently learning a lot about algae and bacteria, so I'm about to press enter on that. Katie's presentation is fantastic, so I'm really bummed.
It's more fantastic when it rolls through smoothly.
This has a way of building suspense, though.
So. However you want to spin it.
Maybe it's the polls this time kind of happened after that, so.
Yeah, I don't know. We might try, if it cuts out one more time, we're gonna try yet another different hotspot because I have like three internet sources in my home and did not anticipate that being a problem. But you know, what have we learned after 3 years of doing this? Okay, resharing. We might just, let's just skip the polls.
Okay.
Maybe that's our bad juju. Am I? Okay, is that back up?
Yep, you're sharing.
Can we see it?
Yes.
We just love interacting with the audience though. So I'm really, we love our polls.
All righty, Katie, are you there?
Might open up the PowerPoint and maybe I can share it from my end. Maybe that'll be easier.
Oh, sure.
Okay, let me message her and see where the newest version of the file is.
Okay. I am screen sharing. Yes?
Yes, it looks
okay. So other regional considerations are what is the use of the land? So we have what is the natural state of the land, right? What is the ecology of the land? And then we also have what is the use of the land? So our BMPs also have to be tailored to what we need to do on the landscape. So here in our watersheds, again, I have them kind of outlined. We are largely a rangeland landscape. There is a good amount of cropland, grow crops happening down here in the Richland Chambers watershed, but by and large, we are range. Now, the types of satellite imagery that they use to develop these maps are not necessarily differentiating between native range and non-native range, but we do know that most of this space is kind of open. We don't quite dip over, you know, into the pine curtain over here, but you can see really clearly, I just think this is cool, in the Cedar Creek watershed, that the riparian corridors, the forested corridors over in this watershed are still really intact and really clear because you can follow these forested lines as they follow the creeks, which is just kind of fun. And this red, obviously that's the urban area. You can see it bleeding up into Eagle Mountain and it's just starting to bleed down into Richland Chambers down here. So that changing land use over time is going to be a consideration as we think about what best management practices are most appropriate. So, but for right now, we're focusing mainly on rangeland because that is the current state of the watersheds. So some of the best management practices that we promote, I pulled out a selection of them that really specifically have wildlife benefit implications. So the first one is native range seeding. This is really self-explanatory. It's exactly what it sounds like. We go out onto the landscape and broadcast native seed. There are a number of different ways to do this. A lot of times there is some prep work involved and that prep work can involve herbicide application, especially for certain invasive species if we need to knock them back in order to make space for the native plants. But overall, we really like this because it's pretty simple to implement and it has, you know, really obvious water quality and wildlife implications. So if you look at this diagram over on the right, a lot of y'all have probably seen something like this before. There's a popular version of it that's really, really big and has like 15 different grass species on it. I don't have room for that on my slide, so we're going to look at this miniature version. If you look at our native grasses over here, you can see that their root systems are much more robust than these, you know, introduced forage grasses over on the left. So these root systems are going to do a much better job of holding on to that sediment, and they are providing better infiltration pathways for the water. So basically, if you think about the soil as a sponge, right, these introduced grasses have a really small sponge, but these native grasses are creating a much deeper soil sponge. So this landscape right here is going to be much more resilient to climate and weather events over time, because it's storing water deep in the profile where it is not really susceptible to evaporation. So in times of drought, this native landscape is going to be much more alive, much more useful to wildlife, and provide much better ground cover for water quality than this introduced landscape. One of the things that's really important is to ensure that the species mixes are appropriate for the area. That goes back to those regional considerations, right? We're not going to put the same species mix necessarily in, you know, the central Great Plains as we would put in the Blackland Prairie. There might be some overlap, but it's not going to be exactly the same. And this can even vary, you know, within one property on one ranch, because there are different soil types, different soil depths, different slopes and aspects on different areas of the property. So it's really important to work with an expert to make sure that you're really, you know, maximizing the potential of that landscape and getting the absolute best species out there. This one I'm going to touch on really briefly. We do encourage people sometimes to engage in brush clearing. Without grazing or fire, woody species can take over a landscape that was supposed to be prairie. We often don't like to talk about cutting down trees. That feels icky and weird. But if a landscape is intended to be prairie, it has been prairie, that's the system that we want to maintain. And sometimes, if the system has been thrown out of balance, the trees and woody species and brush take over, and we have to kind of mechanically go in and knock that back. Now, I will say it looks really bad at first because the landscape is really bare. You see a ton of bare dirt here. A mitigating thing would be to go in and, you know, put something down that's going to grow quickly to help cover that surface. But what we find a lot of times in situations like this is that there's actually a native seed bank already living in that soil that just needs space and light in order to grow. So sometimes you don't even need to come through and do a bunch of rounds of native range seeding for this. Sometimes it's already there. It just needed the space. So you can kind of see over time, you know, what used to be on the landscape, because you'll see what starts popping up after the trees are removed. Now, we usually don't want to take all of them out. It's good to leave some strategically placed woody patches or motts, because animals will use that. So deer will come out from the forest edges and browse these areas. Small animals like ground birds and small mammals will use it for cover, especially from overhead predators like birds of prey. And of course, like tree nesting birds like this, they have some place to live and forage as well. Prescribed fire, this is the one that everyone gets most excited about. Texas prairies are a fire adapted landscape. The really cool thing about prescribed fire is that we can time it strategically for different goals. So certain invasive species are best knocked back with, you know, some of them with a warm season burn in summer, some of them with a cooler season burn. Some, if you burn really, really hot, we can kill certain species, et cetera, et cetera. So we can kind of tailor the type of burn and the timing of the burn to what the specific goals on the property are. Again, just like brush clearing, this can kind of awaken and make space for a dormant seed bank that's already existing to emerge. And this is all really important for wildlife because, again, we're increasing the diversity of the system. We're preserving the landscape as prairie. And another thing is that it keeps even our native species from getting too big and thatchy. So a lot of our native grass species are bunch grasses. Bunch grasses grow, it's almost like tree rings over time. They kind of get wider and wider and put on more layers. So if those bunches get too big and they all start to run into each other, there's no pathways for, you know, ground birds, small mammals, or insects to move around. There's no space for other grasses and forbs to grow up. So we actually have to even keep our native species at bay with, you know, occasional fire so that they don't get too big for the good of the system. Last range BMP that we're going to talk about real quick is prescribed grazing. I do not have an ag background. I have a landscape ecology background. So this is something that I really learned about after coming into this job. And it kind of blew my mind, actually. In a traditional grazing regime, what we do is we take a big ranch, divide it up into maybe a few large pastures, and just throw a bunch of cattle out there and just leave them there for a long time. And what'll happen is the cows are going to walk around. They have, right, they have favorite flavors, favorite tastes, just like we do. And they're going to go to their favorite plants and they are going to graze that plant over and over and over again. Every time it sends up a new little shoot, they're going to say, oh my God, my favorite plant is back. I'm going to go eat that snack. And what happens is over time, that plant is having to spend all of its energy trying to grow new stems and leaves, and it's not putting a lot of energy into growing its roots. So over time, this plant is going to die. So kind of ironically, these cattle end up selecting against their favorite foods because they're going to kill them off, and it's going to decrease the diversity of the system. So what we can do instead is divide that property into a number of smaller pastures. You put the same number of cattle on it and they graze it really intensively for a short period of time. Now, in that short period of time, they are going to be forced to eat the whole buffet, right? They cannot just eat their favorite things down to the nub. They have to eat the whole buffet. And then as soon as that little, you know, pasture, that little area cannot take any more grazing pressure, they move on. And that's going to be rested for a long time. So these plants have a really long recovery period to devote energy to both their root response and their, you know, stem and leaf response. So by the time the cattle make it all the way back around, you have really healthy plants. The trampling action and the fertilization that comes from, you know, the waste products of the cattle also are going to help that, that little area, that little pasture regenerate. And so basically what we've done with this system is we're mimicking the movement and grazing behavior of native ungulates like bison. I'm sure a lot of us in the wildlife space would say, hey, wouldn't it be great if we could just like clear out the landscape, take away all the fences and throw a bunch of herds of bison out there. And like, sure, that would be how the native ecosystem works. But thinking back to our regional considerations, it's not just about what the native ecosystem is, it's also about what the land use is. The reality is that we are humans on the landscape and we have to use it in some way. So this is kind of a marriage of, you know, trying to really boost the ecosystem while also having a productive land use. Very, very briefly about farms, because we do have some row crop areas. We don't really think of farms generally as an area that wildlife can use. And I'm using farm instead of just cropland because I'm also including solar farms in this. This is I'm sure a lot of y'all are aware, a really quickly growing land use is big utility scale solar farms. So this is a practice that can be used in both instances, filter strips and buffers. So basically on the edges of the fields, whether that be crop fields or solar fields, we can put plants out there that will slow the runoff coming off of those landscapes, trap the sediment. And then if we're really strategic about using native plants like native pollinator plants, that can benefit the wildlife, the pollinators in the area. And the pollinators can also have a reciprocal benefit on the crops. So that's kind of a good self-fulfilling feedback loop as well. In the background of this picture, you can see some trees back here. I talked in a previous slide about the riparian corridors where you could see, you know, kind of that line of forested area following the creeks. This is another really great way that we can slow the runoff and trap sediment and pollutants right before it enters the waterway. And this has great co-benefits for wildlife because this is a transportation corridor, kind of a protected corridor that wildlife can use to move about the landscape. And it keeps the streams, those actual water bodies, shaded and cool. So a lot of aquatic species, you know, they have temperature thresholds that they can live within. So these forested buffers help, you know, keep the water temperature within the thresholds that those aquatic species want. Super, super fast, so that we still have time for some questions. Due to my technical issues, I'm going to run through a few of our programs that we do that benefit wildlife. One of them, this is not my team, the Shannon Wetlands and Richland Creek Wildlife Management Area. The Wildlife Management Area is a partnership with Texas Parks and Wildlife. This is a really cool system where we pump water from the Trinity River into a constructed wetland system. So it's flowing in this direction from the bottom right corner of the picture to the top left corner of the picture. And you can see how the wetland system is cleaning the water over time. So the sediment trapping effect is really, really obvious. Wetland plants are also really good at something called phytoremediation. So they are taking up a lot of the nutrients that are in the water. Again, those nutrients could have been coming from the agricultural landscape. They can also be coming from wastewater effluent. So we're taking those nutrients out of the water before putting the water into the lake. This isn't necessarily a problem with our water, but there have been studies that have shown that some wetland plants can even perform phytoremediation of things like heavy metals. So wetland plants are really these absolute superstars of the plant world. And of course, this is a really incredible wildlife area. If you are a birder and you live anywhere in North Texas and you haven't been out here, spring and fall migration season are a great time to visit. They have had hundreds of species of birds come through this property, and it is open to the public. So if you're into that, check it out. I'm going to steal Michelle's thunder a little bit. This is her program. This is looking kind of at how we can control for water quality and provide co-benefits for wildlife in an urban setting. So traditionally, you know, the urban landscape might look very, very gray like this. What we try to do is kind of marry the, you know, necessities of that gray landscape with some ecosystem functionality. So we have things like rain gardens. These little rock channels act like dry creek beds. So we're trying to provide for infiltration, slowing down of that water, and utilizing native plants and some strategically standing water that provides wildlife habitat, forage for pollinators and birds, et cetera. The crowning glory of this system is our detention wetland. So everyone here has probably seen a detention basin before. It's just kind of a big grassy pit. It is not that functional for anything other than detaining water. So what we did is we took our detention basin on campus and turned it into a wetland. It has different pools, which you can kind of see from this picture. So different depths in the wetland, water kind of flows through it. We have all kinds of native wetland plants, and we see lots of different swimming and wading birds using this area. We've even caught some small mammals. That's a little gray fox up in the corner. And I don't know if you could see from the previous picture, this is downtown Fort Worth. So we're kind of creating this really great little miniature wildlife refuge, you know, a mile or two north of downtown Fort Worth, which is really, really cool. Very briefly, Western Navarro Bobwhite Recovery Initiative. This is a really small program, but I wanted to mention it because I really like this idea of taking advantage of a charismatic wildlife like the bobwhite quail and using that to achieve greater ecosystem and hydrologic function. So this program is basically just aimed at improving bobwhite quail habitat within that little green footprint that you see in the bottom left. And of course, as we've been through ad nauseum in this presentation, if we're improving habitat, we're also improving water quality. Those benefits go hand in hand. And this is cool because it can capture all kinds of audiences. There are birders, like people who just think the quail are cute and want to see them. There are sportsmen who want to bring back the quail for hunting purposes. And what we hear from a lot of landowners is that they want to bring back the quail because they've lived on this landscape for decades. And they remember when they were kids, they could hear the quail and see the quail all the time. And they want to make sure that their kids and grandkids have that same experience. So it really becomes this kind of, heritage or tradition discussion. So charismatic wildlife can grab onto a lot of different people. And really taking advantage of them is a great way to achieve a number of ecological benefits. I'm going to skip over this for the sake of time. I want to give a quick shout out to the NRCS, the Soil and Water Conservation Districts, and Texas Parks and Wildlife Department. We do throw some funding into some of their programs to help offset, match funds for, federal best management practice funding for ag landscapes. We also just go out and we try to support, their events. We try to support the technical assistance that they're providing. These are our partners that really have their boots on the ground. We have 3 full-time staff in the Watershed Protection Program for watersheds that touch almost 20 counties. But these agencies are out there in the counties working with the landowners. They have great relationships with the people who live out there. And we rely so heavily on them to really get our programmatic goals done. And then I'm going to skip through these last couple. I don't know if Michelle wants to mention anything about Wildlife Conservation Camp because that is coming up.
Yes. So thank you for sharing about the rainscapes. If you guys are in Fort Worth or want to contact us, we would love to give you guys a tour of the rainscapes. We have this slide in here because I do a lot of outdoor education, and Wildlife Conservation Camp was how I learned about all the different ecology and careers. So when I was a high schooler, I went. Brigades is also really good, and the Range Society also has a camp. So I really recommend sending this. This is how I learned about entomology and bug picking, and my career here is all based on the connections and the volunteers that poured into me. So that's my little spiel on Wildlife Conservation Camp.
Thanks, Michelle. Okay, this is going to be my last slide. This QR code is for our newsletter. So if you live in any of the areas on this map and you want to stay up to date with what we are doing, you can scan that QR code and sign up for our newsletter. I only send it out 4 times a year, so I promise I'm not going to spam you with it. It just, kind of lets you know what we're up to. I try to post events that will be, of interest to landowners that live in these areas. It's pretty low key, but we really like, having that interaction and that pathway to the stewards of the landscape. So again, if you live in these areas, or even if you don't, and you're just curious about what we do with our time, you're welcome to join that newsletter. And I'm gonna leave that up while we jump into however many minutes we have for questions.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for that, Katie and Michelle, and for everyone else for sticking with us through a few technical issues there in the middle of the presentation. I will turn it over to the group. If anyone has any additional questions for either Katie or Michelle that you'd like to ask, please fire away.
Katie, can you see the Q&A pop up? I'm actually trying to reply to One more question from the chat, but there's some directed to you there, and I can read them if you can't read them.
I am not Zoom intelligent.
So
I want to read them to you.
There's a couple questions from Brian here. It says, Katie, can you discuss practices that keep soil and sediment on our nation's farm and ranch land where they are a national asset and out of rivers, lakes, and oceans where they are a national liability? I think you kind of got into that with a lot of the practices, both fire and grazing and cover cropping and elsewhere that you discussed. How does water retention relate to carbon sequestration?
So it is related through the idea that water retention in the soil profile is going to, you know, promote more robust growth of the grasses. And the more, you know, growth and production we have, the more carbon we are sequestering into the soil. So they're just really connected in the fact that they are both factoring into, you know, optimum growth of the plants.
Any other questions out there in the ether? Otherwise, I'll throw one your way, Katie. And then Brian actually had a great question in the Q&A that we will close out with. But you mentioned the benefit of the cost benefit down the road of natural infrastructure solutions. And I was curious that if TRWD can include that in kind of the avoided costs when they calculate the costs of implementing any of these projects or practices that you put out on the landscape. So kind of if you're able to do any kind of dynamic scoring of, as you mentioned, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure.
So we don't do any kind of advanced accounting like that right now. The math and the science is really complex, right? And ecosystem services is a science that is very much still in development and can be a little contentious about, you know, exactly, you know, how much is prevention of X number of tons of sediment worth from a monetary perspective, right? How do we assign monetary values to that? So we haven't done any of our own kind of studies or accounting of that kind. I rely on what the best science is that I can find, which there's actually a lot of great work on ecosystem services coming out of one of my alma maters, Duke. They have a whole research section on that, if anyone's interested on checking it out. But yeah, I mean, right now, and that's a direction that I would like to move in, obviously not developing our own monetary values, but taking better advantage of what information is out there, because that is how we justify, you know, our work and our existence in the company is that we are saving money in the long term. And it is really, really difficult to account for. You know, it's easy to point to, you know, something in the built environment and say, we spent X number of dollars on building this piece of concrete, right? That we think provides this benefit. It's a lot harder to say, well, we planted some grass there and over time it might defray the cost of doing this thing, right? We're talking about future costs, which is a hard sell a lot of times.
Absolutely. I'm going to include the recording of this presentation on TWA's Vimeo channel. It'll be available online, but are you able to share out your presentation in PDF form?
Yes. Okay, great. I can definitely do that.
So if you'd like to share that with me, I can get it out to today's participants. I know a couple folks were asking about that.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then, one final question, and maybe this is one for you and Michelle, especially given her role with TRWD, but what can individual homeowners and larger landowners do to help mitigate flooding and water pollution in their own property?
I see Michelle smiling, so I'm going to let her go for it.
Yes, I'll add the newsletter link to the chat for sure. I'm smiling because my mission in life possibly is answering that question. So I get geeked out whenever people are like, here's a soapbox, please step on it. So what I teach is that we're all part of the water cycle, and we're all called to be stewards, and we are all neighbors to someone. We are either upstream from someone and contribute to the water quality that goes on their property, or we're downstream from someone, right? Like, we're all breathing the same air. So there's a whole community ecological aspect, as well as the social aspect, that combines us with the water cycle and water use. So we have, if you go to our website, and I'll throw this link up too, we have for the rainscapes a story map. So some of those answers and photos are on the story map, and I'll share that. But slowing the water down on site is really great. Water is a crop. That's a whole new way for urban and rural people to think. And then lawns as a crop. If you think about what is the biggest crop in the US and you consider turf grass and lawns, then that's one of the biggest crops. So if you think of it in a whole new light, and you kind of like look at it from a different angle, then every square inch of your property, your balcony in your apartment, your school, all of it becomes where water interacts with the human environment and the ground and the soil. And so you can slow water down everywhere. You can reuse and conserve water everywhere. And so when you think about it from that kind of angle, stormwater in Texas isn't cleaned. It goes straight into our creeks and rivers, and then it goes into our reservoirs and our water supply. So ecosystem services, like Katie was saying, and I know I'm taking up everyone's time, but ecosystem services is just a really, like, that's how you can clean it without having someone pay for it later, right? We pay to have clean water piped to us. But if we can treat the source water, the rainwater, as it hits our roof and our, you know, place that we live, work, and play, then we can really slow it down and reduce flooding, and we can keep it cleaner for our neighbors, because the water we drink came from somebody else's property, and the water that rains on our property is going to be someone else's drinking water. And when we think about it like that, it's a lot closer of a system. So thank you for my soapbox, and I will post those links.
All right. Well, I'll put a call out for any final questions here, as we're just past the 1 o'clock hour. If anyone has any other pressing thoughts, please feel free to air them. Otherwise, thank you very much, Katie and Michelle, for your time and everything that went into putting this wonderful presentation together for this group. Thank you for everyone for joining us. And I will be following up with a link to the recording, as well as the presentation provided by Katie. And we will be in touch later this summer for the next installment of TWA's Wild at Work Stewardship Seminar Series. Thank you so much, and have a great afternoon.